This morning we complete our journey, well, not complete, but we finish our journey through the book of Ephesians for these 4 weeks, right? Our sitcom theology. We did, for the little recap real quick here, we did 4 weeks, 3 weeks ago on the farm, Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. 2 weeks ago, Different Strokes. Last week was Cheers. And this week we'll get to in just a moment. But we have this reading from Ephesians that talks about the armor of God, right? The author says to those in Ephesus, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you might..." What? Why are we putting on the armor of God? What? To stand against the wiles of the devil. Right? And then again later, he says again, "Therefore take up the whole armor of God so that you will be able to withstand on that evil day. And having done everything, you will stand firm." Right? We're not putting on this armor of God to go on the offensive. You're not putting on God's armor to go out into the world and start taking names and busting people down. That's not what it's about. You put on the armor so that you're able to stand firm against all of the evil in the world, right? And who are we standing against? For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. So is this telling us we need to revolt? No, it's not. It does say, but against the rulers, against authorities. But you have to read that part right before that. What does he say? If our struggle is not against flesh and blood, which means people. Our struggle is not with each other. Our struggle is not with those who are sitting next to us, even though sometimes it might be. Our struggle is not with those who don't believe the same thing as us, even though we think it might be. Our struggle is not against any other human entity. Our struggle is against the rulers and authorities of this world where evil is lurking and alive. It's not against human rulers. Against powers which we cannot combat on our own. But we need the help of God. And therefore, God gives us the gift of his armor, which is not, could be, construed to be the same thing as the Romans have. But more than likely, it's talking about what God himself has said that he is using. If you look in the book of Isaiah in chapter 59, and in the book of Wisdom in chapter 5, God himself talks about how he has put on his own armor to go out and to fight for justice and for peace in the world. That he's using his truth. He's using his righteousness. He's using his understanding of the world to fight when no one else is able to. And now here in Ephesians, the author is telling us that God himself is giving us what he himself has used. God is giving you your cape. God is giving you the very thing that he himself has used. God is giving you the very thing that he has worked in the world to use and to make known to people. And have put on one of them. Okay, it's okay. And he asks you to put it on. And he asks you to stand. And how can we do that? Who's ready to do what the author of Ephesians has asked them to do in chapter 6? Who's ready? I got one, two half-hearted kind of like. I'm not going to really raise it all the way up because people can't see it. I'm just going to kind of go like this and say yes. So we're not really. Oh, I got one in the back. Right?
I'm just thinking about trying.
You got to start somewhere, Clyde. So there you go. Right? Right. Because it's not, you know, when we think about it, we think it's not easy. It's not something that we want to do. Which brings us to our sitcom
for the week, if you will. How many of you remember a TV show from the early 80s?
Because you watched it with me. That's not fair. My wife is shaking her head. Yeah, I just almost watched the whole first season Thursday night, so there's only 9 episodes in the whole first season. So it's a TV show that came in, I think, like 1981 is a long time ago, about a high school special education teacher who was taking kids on a trip out into the desert, and he met an FBI agent, and he met some aliens, and the aliens gave him a superhero suit. I get some delivery books. The Greatest American Hero. You don't remember it, it's actually an interesting, very funny show. He was a high school teacher, his name was Ralph Hinkley, which the interesting part of that is, for those of you who might remember some more history of 1981, the then president was shot by a man named Hinkley. So the producers actually changed the character's name for a couple episodes and then went back to Hinkley in year two. But Ralph Hinkley was the school teacher who was a special ed teacher who met with kids who were on the verge of being kicked out of school. It's not really special education as we think of it, but special ed for high school kids who maybe got in a little bit more trouble than some other kids. So they were on the way out of school. So he tried to help them to remain in school. And on a field trip where he's taking these kids out, his bus breaks down and aliens come and they give him the super suit. And as they give him the super suit, he puts it in the trunk of his car, and then the friend that he's with takes it out and gives it back to him, makes him walk back to the bus that he had his kids in. And in the midst of doing this, he drops the instruction manual for his suit. So he doesn't know how the suit works, and he doesn't know how anything works. But he has all of these great powers. He can see things that are going to happen. He can see things that have happened. He can see things that are happening right now. He can turn invisible. He can fly. He can combat bullets. He's bulletproof. He has immense strength, and he doesn't get hurt. See, the thing that really makes this funny, though, is in all three seasons, as he's flying, he's able to learn how to fly because a little boy tells him how to fly. First of all, he says, you've got to take 3 steps and then jump. Right? It's like everybody knows when you take off a fly, you've got to take 3 steps and you jump. So he can take off and he can fly, but he can never land. Right? Because he didn't have the book, he didn't get an innate ability to land. So when he lands, he more oftentimes crashes and rolls on the ground as he lands from flying. So he's not very graceful in his superhero-ness because he just doesn't have that ability, or he lost the instruction manual. He doesn't know what he's doing. And he's kind of making it up and learning things as he goes. Right? Which is why it fits so perfectly with our reading this morning. Because every one of us has these gifts from God.
And God has given us gifts
in the armor to be who he's called us to be. To stand firm in the world and to show forth his love to everyone. Right? He's given us this armor. What is this armor? The belt of truth. And you put on the breastplate of righteousness. So we've got truth. And we've got righteousness. And then you put on shoes. What kind of shoes? Any shoes. That allow you to not stand firm, proclaim the gospel of peace. So we have truth, righteousness, and peace. And then he says to take up the shield of faith. Here's the interesting part about how if we wanted to put this with Roman soldiers. Did you know that a Roman soldier's shield was covered with leather and usually soaked in water? And why? Why? It actually tells you in the reading today. Bless you.
to withstand flaming arrows. It would actually extinguish the arrows, because the leather would hold the water and put the arrows out when they hit. The other interesting part to a Roman centurion's shield is it was big enough to cover their whole body if they squatted down. And it wasn't only big enough to cover their body, but it was big enough to cover their body and one-third of the soldier that stood next to them. So when you link these shields together, they would effectively cover the front of the brigade or the men standing there, so nothing would get around them. That's what God has called all of us to do. Not to stand alone, but stand together. Knowing that nothing can get around. So he's given us truth. He's given us righteousness. He's given us peace. He's given us faith. You put on the helmet of salvation. And what is the thing that links all of these five gifts together? What kind of weapons are these? Defensive. These are not offensive weapons that he gives us here. They're all defensive. A belt to hold your gown, your robe on so you can easily walk or run. A breastplate that covers your chest to protect you. Shoes to make you to be able to stand firm wherever you're at. The shield, which protects you from anything. And the helmet, which covers your head and protects your head. And then the very last one is what? The sword of the Spirit, which is this right here. How many of you have one of these with you? He does. You have one on your phone too, so yeah. How many of you have a smartphone? How many of you did you know there's an app for that? Right? You can have a Bible on your phone. How many of you have one of these that you actually open? Don't raise your hands. Think about that for a moment, though. You know, I have a whole shelf. I actually have two or three shelves full of these things in there, and they don't hardly ever get open on my shelf. Because I have most of them on, like Kurt, I have most of them on a computer, so I look at them on a computer, and I look at different translations. But I made a point, I don't even know how long ago now it was, to start reading the gospel out of this. Because while we read it out of the bulletin, and yes, it is God's word, it gives a little bit more visual to the understanding. And it helps us to realize that this is a book that shouldn't just collect dust. This is a book that we should actually read and a book that we should actually know. Because out of the six things that God gives us this morning, the first five are defensive, the last one is actually both. Right? It can be offensive, but it can also be defensive if we're thinking about it in this sense. As a sword, it is very offensive. But if you're thinking about it as a metaphor for what this is, it's both. And I take that going back to when Jesus met the power that we're talking about here in the wilderness after being in the desert for 40 days. He met with the devil, and what did the devil do? He tempted him. And on the second temptation, what did the devil do? What did he quote? He quoted Scripture. So not only do we need to know this to be able to tell people about God's grace and about God's peace and about God's love, we need to know this in order to use it when the devil comes at us, or those forces of evil come at us, because they know this better than we do. That's why I say it's defensive, too. Okay? So God gives us these gifts and calls us to be His people, not on our own, but united together as His body, each with our own gift, each using our own peace, and playing out our role in the world. So I call you, as God has called you, to live in truth and
righteousness, and to be a beacon of His peace, living under the faith that He's given you and the salvation that He has provided you, using His Spirit and His Word to stand firm against everything that will come at you, together with each other. Because believe it or not, you have the armor, and you do have that armor, and you can do what He's called you to do. So, I want each of us to take this chorus of the theme song this morning from The Greatest American Hero and take it to heart. The chorus is, believe it or not, I'm walking on air. I never thought I could feel so free. Flying away on a wing and a prayer, who could it be? Believe it or not, it's just me. So like Ralph Kingsley, you were given a gift. And no, we don't always know how to use it. But God's always going to be there with you. So put it on. And as Clyde said, try. Because that's all God is asking.